لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحابته أجمعين، وبعد، فقد قال الله تعالى: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. وقال تعالى: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. One of the beautiful characteristics of our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم that we were going to speak about last week was how the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would not be shy, would not be afraid to express his own weakness, his own inability. And this separates the Prophet's messengers of Allah and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from a king, a ruler, a person of might and power who is void of guidance, hidayah. Usually a ruler, a person of authority, a person who people look up to, and sometimes not even those who are that high up, even those who are in authority of a lesser degree. They have authority over a small group of people. They run an organization or they run an institution and they have some people under them, usually people of authority. They're not quick to accept their own deficiencies, accept their own mistakes. Usually you find such people who are full of arrogance and full of themselves. They try to cover up their deficiencies. They're never ready to accept them. Even if it means they're never ready to accept their wrong decisions, even if it means thousands of people have to die. But still, they would not be willing to bow their head in arrogance. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not one to behave in such a manner. And this is what sets him apart from other human beings. Although he was the messenger of Allah, he was the ruler. He was the ruler of the khilafah of his time. He was the general, right? He was the best human being on earth. All human beings had to follow him. He had such authority that no other human being had on earth. In spite of all of that authority, he had people who were ready to lay down their lives for him. But still, the humility and the humbleness is something we cannot imagine, and something that should lead us to fall in love with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was on the occasion of the incident of Ta'if, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in such distress. That year was called the year of grief, Amul Huzn, the year in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's closest companion, the most beloved to him, and the one who supported him from the beginning, the first one to accept Islam, Khadija radiallahu anha, she had passed away in that year. His closest relatives, although he had not accepted Islam, was his greatest support. He was the one who was preventing the Quraysh from persecuting and torturing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the way they used to persecute and torture others. Basically, he was the protection for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His uncle Abu Talib, he also passed away, and this was considered to be the year of grief for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, extreme sorrow. This is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously through the instruction of Allah, decided to go to the people of Ta'if and see if he could convince them, after failing to convince the people of Mecca, after 10 years, that these people are still not willing to accept Islam and to support this mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Maybe the people of Ta'if will agree. Maybe they will be convinced and I could spread Islam from there. With that intention, the Prophet ﷺ went to Ta'if. The famous incident where he spoke to the chiefs of Taif, and we know how they responded. The three different chiefs he went to, and eventually they insulted him on his face. They insulted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They belittled him, right, by saying, "Who are you that God made you the prophet, right? Couldn't he find anyone else besides you?" And in this way, they insulted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not only did they stop at insulting him, but they instructed the mischief people of the town, the low people of society, to pursue the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was with his close companion Zayd ibn Haritha radiyallahu anha, who was also with him on this journey. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam realized that these people are not going to respond positively, and he was leaving the city, they told the low people of the city, these people of mischief, to pursue the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and mock him, to jeer at him, make fun of him, to pelt him with stones. And in this way, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was forced out of the city of Mecca. And we know the narration, Aisha radiallahu anha, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam experienced what he experienced in the Battle of Uhud, when there was chaos, and the Muslims were fleeing in different directions, and only a small group of Sahaba radiallahu anhu remained with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the disbelievers were able to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly. A sword was struck on his helmet. The links of his helmet went into his cheeks. One of his teeth were chipped, and he fell into a ditch, and he started bleeding, and he was wiping the blood, attempting for this blood not to fall on the ground. Because when the blood of a prophet falls on the ground, then the wrath of Allah descends. So when Aisha radiallahu anha, after seeing what had happened in the Battle of Uhud, asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "O Prophet of Allah, was there any day more difficult for you?" Like Uhud, what you went through in Uhud, was there any day more difficult for you than Uhud? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remembered and he said, "Yes, I had a more difficult day than Uhud. That's the day when I took my message to the son of Abdul Ya'lil and these chiefs of Ta'if. That day was the most difficult day of my life, what I experienced." You can just imagine, not just the physical injuries, but the internal injuries, the trauma, the insult, the mocking. The Prophet would say, "I never experienced such humiliation, such mockery, such persecution, like on the day of Ta'if. This was the most difficult day for the Prophet." His sandals became clogged with his blood, and he's walking out of the city or running out of the city in this way with Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu, until they got to an orchard of grapes and they settled, and the people of the city returned. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam settled down and he was treating his wounds, this is when he made this prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is now recorded in the books of ahadith, that becomes a prayer for the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they are in these type of situations. And what the Prophet ﷺ went through in Ta'if, the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ is going through that right now. This level of persecution that, you know, let alone the ummah of Muhammad ﷺ, the believers, even the disbelievers can't believe what they are seeing with their eyes. Even they are speaking up, like, how is this happening? How are people doing this to innocent children, women, elderly? How can they be allowing this? Like, this is beyond humanity. This is beyond human comprehension. How could some people be oppressing human beings in this way? Such oppression the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going through right now. So in this state of extreme hurt, injury, and extreme humiliation, and after experiencing such insult, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he did not point his fingers at the people who did this to him. He had the ability to, right? He did not express what he was worth. He did not express that I'm worthy of great respect and honor, and how did these people treat me? This is not an appropriate way to treat such an important person like me. No, he didn't respond in this way. He turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he taught us how to humble ourselves before Allah, how to acknowledge our deficiencies, and how to put before Allah when we don't have any other way to address the situation, to turn to Allah and say, "Oh Allah, we are weak." He said, "Allahumma ilayka ashku da'fa quwwati wa qillata hilati wa hawani 'ala an-nas ya arhamar rahimin." He prayed by saying, "Oh Allah, to you I complain about da'fa quwwati, the weakness of my power, that I am weak, oh Allah. Ilayka ashku da'fa quwwati, the weakness of my ability, my power, my energy, wa qillata hilati, and the lack of my planning, that possibly because of my lack of planning this has happened. These people have treated me in this way because I wasn't able to plan appropriately. Wa qillata hilati wa hawani 'ala an-nas, and my humiliation amongst people, oh Allah, I complain to you about it." Right, this is my state, right? I feel like I haven't done my job the way I should have. I'm complaining about my own weakness. I don't have the strength I need. I don't have that honor amongst people that I should have, that the people would respect me. Rather, they treated me in this way. So he lowered himself so much before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, "Anta Rabbul Mustada'afin." You are the Lord of the weak. "Anta Rabbi." You are my Lord. "Ila man takiluni." And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in complaining to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and putting his matter before Allah, he says, "Oh Allah, ila man takiluni." Like, who did you leave me to? Like, what kind of people did you leave me to? Like we say today, "Ya Allah, what kind of people have you left the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to?" Right? People who do not have any regard for children, for women, for elderly, who are intentionally starving these human beings to death. Something that a person would not do to an animal, let alone a human being. They are doing to a human being. "Ila man takiluni," the Prophet ﷺ said, "who did you leave me to?" "Ila qari, ila aduwin yatajahamuni," to an enemy who has absolute control over me, that they did what they want with me, and I could not do anything in return. I could not resist in any way. "Ila aduwin yatajahamuni," to an enemy who has complete power and control over me. "Am ila ba'idin mallaktahu," or some narrations, "qaribin mallaktahu amri," or to a stranger who you have given control over my affairs to a stranger who you have given to him control over my affairs. "Aduwi yatajahamuni am ila ba'idin mallaktahu amri." Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "illam yakun bika ghad, illam yakun علي غضب, إن لم يكن علي غضبك فلا أبالي." Oh Allah, all of this has happened, right? This has happened to me, oh Allah, and these people have done this to me, and I know, you know, I am not strong enough, and I have this. And after saying all of this, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, "إن لم يكن غضبك علي فلا أبالي." But oh Allah, if you're not angry with me in spite of all of this, then I don't care. In spite of all of this that's happening to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we turn to Allah and say, "Oh Allah, if you're not angry with these individuals, with these people, then فَلَا نُبَالِي." Like, we don't care, meaning your decision is full of wisdom. You have knowledge and you know why you're doing what you are doing and why what is happening is happening. As long as you're not angry with us, this should be our greatest concern, that what is happening is not because Allah is angry with us, but rather Allah wants good for us. So as long as the Prophet ﷺ says, "illam yakun ghadabuka alayya fala ubali," as long as you're not displeased with me, I don't care whatever you decide for me. Whether you decide honor for me or whether you decide for me to be tortured, as long as you're not displeased with me, I'm happy with your decision. "Illam yakun ghadabuka alayya fala ubali." But then the Prophet ﷺ also expresses his human side. Although we are pleased with Allah's decision, but we are humans. Again, we are weak and we ask for the best situation. We don't ask for the worst of our situations. So the Prophet ﷺ goes on to say, "illam yakun ghadabuka alayya fala ubali ghayra anna afiyataka hiya awsa'u li," except for the fact that, "Ya Allah, your afiyah is better for me." Like if you put me in a situation of humiliation and torture, and if you're still happy with me, I don't mind. I have no objection to it. But I seek your afiyah. Oh Allah, protect the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't put the ummah through this humiliation, through this torture. Relieve the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from this type of occupation and persecution and torture and oppression. غَيْرَ أَنَّ عَافِيَتَكَ هِيَ أَوْسَعُلِي. Your afiyah is more vast and more better for me. I ask you for afiyah. I don't ask you for this humiliation or this torture or persecution. We don't ask for it. If it happens, we are pleased with Allah's decision, but we ask Allah to protect us from such situations. And then the Prophet ﷺ says, أَعُوذُ بِنُورِ وَجْهِكَ الَّذِي أَشْرَقَتْ لَهُ الظُّلُمَاتِ وَصَلَحَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Oh Allah, I seek your protection. I ask you for your protection through that light of yours. اللَّهُ نُورُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. I ask you for protection through that light of yours by which all the darknesses of the heavens and the earth are enlightened. Everything has light because of the light of Allah. Or else the whole world, the whole universe would be dark if it was not for the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَعُوذُ بِنُورِ وَجْهِكَ, the light of your countenance, by which أَشْرَقَتْ لَهُ الظُّلُمَاتِ, all the darknesses of this world are enlightened and are removed. وَصَلَحَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, and the matter of this world and the hereafter is reformed through your countenance and through you. You are the one who can rectify all the affairs of this world and the hereafter. I ask you through that light of yours and that countenance of yours and that control and might of yours. أعوذ بنور وجهك الذي أشرقت له الظلمات وصلح عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة أن تحل علي غضبك. That you send down on me your wrath. Oh Allah, I seek your protection from that. Don't become angry with me. أو يحل علي سخطك, or your anger descends upon me. That you send down upon me your wrath or your anger descends upon me, I seek your protection from this. This is what we should be seeking protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we ask Allah, oh Allah, in this situation, don't become angry with us. Don't let your wrath depend on us. Let this be a source of mercy for the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أن تحل علي غضبك وتنزل علي سخطك لك العتبة حتى ترضى لك العتبة. For you is the final decision. The decision of what this is all going to happen, this is in the hands of Allah. And the decision will, inshallah, be favorable for the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَكَ الْعُتْبَةِ, for you is the best ending, the best decision. You are the best decision maker. لَكَ الْعُتْبَةِ حَتَّى تَرْضَى, until you are pleased, we will continue to beg you, O Allah. حَتَّى تَرْضَى وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِ. There's no power and there's no might except with you, O Allah. In this way, the Prophet ﷺ made this prayer a very powerful prayer. We're ending on this, that such a prayer that when the Prophet ﷺ proceeded in returning to Mecca, a short while later, Jibreel came down, alayhi salam. And O Prophet of Allah, the Prophet has seen the way these people have behaved with you. And he has heard your prayer. And here is the angel of the mountains standing beside me. He conveys his salam to you. He said, salam. And he said, He is at your command. If you command him, he will bring the mountains of Ta'if together, and everyone in between will be crushed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through his mercy for the ummah, but he said, this is not what I wish. I wish that if not these people, the generation of these people will accept Islam. And actually, this is what happened. Eventually, the people of Ta'if came to Medina and accepted Islam. And it was Muhammad ibn Qasim al-Thaqafi. He was the one who brought Islam to our countries. If we really connect the dots, it's the dua of the Prophet ﷺ of Taif that brought Islam to our countries, to India, Pakistan, and all of these places. That whole region, Muhammad ibn Qasim al-Thaqafi, the scholar last week, he was speaking about those conquests. He was the one, and he is from Thaqif, the tribe of Taif, who accepted Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We should learn this dua. We should make this dua. If we can't do it in Arabic, try to do it in our own language. And we should all turn to Allah with this humbleness and humiliation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillah.
الحمد لله الرحيم الرحمن، حث على العناية بصحة الأبدان، وجعل وقايتها وعلاجها من أسباب طول عمر الإنسان. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له الكريم المنان، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبده ورسوله إلى الأنام. فاللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان. أما بعد، فأوصيكم عباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله، فبها تطمئن قلوبكم وتزكو نفوسكم وتسعدون يوم لقاء ربكم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. أيها المصلون، إن العمر هو رأس مال الإنسان وأغلى ما وهبه الرحمن، أقسم الله تعالى به في كتابه، وحثنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على استثماره قبل ذهابه. فما سمي العمر عمراً إلا لكونه عمارة للبدن بالحياة، فبه نعمر الأرض ونبث فيها الحياة. قال الله تعالى: هو أنشأكم من الأرض واستعمركم فيها. وإن طول العمر مما ترغب فيه طبائع النفوس وفطرها. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن من السعادة أن يطول عمره العبد. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: لا يزيد المؤمن عمره إلا خيرا. فانظروا يا عباد الله كيف نظر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى طول العمر نظرة إيجابية، فجعله سبباً لزيادة الخير وتحقيق السعادة. ولما سألته أم أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنها أن يدعو لولدها أنس وهو من خاصة أصحابه، اختار له أدعية جامعة منها الدعاء بطول العمر، فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: اللهم أكثر ماله وولده وأطل حياته واغفر له. فعلى المؤمن أن يستثمر عمره في طاعة ربه وزيادة عمله وأداء مطالب حياته ونفع الآخرين بتجاربه وخبراته. فعن أبي بكرة رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رجلاً قال: يا رسول الله، أي الناس خير؟ قال: من طال عمره وحسن عمله. ولأهمية العمر كان نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم يدعو ربه أن يمتعه فيه بصحته، فكان يكثر أن يقول في دعائه: اللهم متعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقواتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا. اللهم بارك لنا في أعمالنا، وأسعدنا بصحة أبداننا، وزدنا أمانا في أوطاننا، واجعلنا عاملين بأمرك الذي أمرتنا. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين، فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على نبي بعده وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع هديه. عباد الله، إن من أعظم ما يحقق به المرء طول عمره الحفاظ على صحته والحرص على عافيته، فقد دعانا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى ذلك في قوله: اسألوا الله العفو والعافية. فصحة الأبدان أمانة في عنق الإنسان، وهي أول ما يُسأل عنه من النعيم بين يدي الملك الديان. يقال له: ألم نصح لك جسمك؟ فاقدروا يا عباد الله نعمة الصحة حق قدرها، وخذوا بأسبابها استدامتها، وأول ذلك أن تتبعوا إجراءات وقايتها بالبعد عن كل ما يضرها والسعي فيما يحافظ عليها من توازن في المأكل والمشرب وملازمة للمشي والحركة وكل ما يحقق الحياة الصحية السليمة، ومن مواظبة على الفحوصات الطبيعية الدورية، مستثمرين التطور الكبير في علاج كثير من الأمراض المزمنة والتنبؤ بها لتجنب الإصابة بها وتداركها في بدايتها، واحرصوا على صحتكم الاجتماعية بصلة أرحامكم وطيب خلقكم وحسن تعاملكم، واهتموا بصحتكم النفسية بالتحلي بالروح الإيجابية وتجنب أسباب الهموم والأحزان، فإنها من أخطر ما يهلك الأبدان، وقد استعاد منها نبينا عليه الصلاة والسلام، فكان كثيرا ما يقول: اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الهم والحزن، اللهم اجعلنا به مقتدين. وصلي يا ربنا وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين وعن سائر الصحابة الأكرمين. اللهم ارزقنا صحة في أبداننا وعافية في أجسادنا، ومتعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا. اللهم ارحم المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. عباد الله، اذكروا الله العظيم الجليل يذكركم، واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. من جاء بالحسنة فله عشر أمثالها، ومن جاء بالسيئة فلا يجزى إلا مثلها وهم لا يظلمون. قل إنني هداني ربي إلى صراط مستقيم دينا قيما ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين. قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي ومماتي لله رب العالمين لا شريك له وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. قل أغير الله أبغي ربا وهو رب كل شيء ولا تكسب كل نفس إلا عليها ولا تزر وازرة وزر أخرى ثم إلى ربكم مرجعكم فينبئكم بما كنتم فيه تختلفون. وهو الذي جعلكم خلائف الأرض ورفع بعضكم فوق بعض درجات ليبلوكم فيما آتاكم إن ربك سريع العقاب وإنه لغفور رحيم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. سبحان ربي. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. وقال إني ذاهب إلى ربي سيهديني رب هب لي من الصالحين. فبشرناه بغلام حليم فلما بلغ معه السعي قال يا بني إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك فانظر ماذا ترى. قال يا أبت افعل ما تؤمر ستجدني إن شاء الله من الصابرين. فلما أسلما وتله للجبين وناديناه أن يا إبراهيم قد صدقت الرؤيا إنا كذلك نجزي المحسنين إن هذا لهو البلاء المبين وفديناه بذبح عظيم وتركنا عليه في الآخرين سلام على إبراهيم الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر
الله
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
استغفر لا إله إلا الله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله سيدنا محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين وربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين وربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا شر ما قضيت إنك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك إنه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت تباركت ربنا وتعاليت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وألف بين قلوبهم وأصلح ذات بينهم وانصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم اللهم العن الكفرة الذين يصدون عن سبيلك ويكذبون رسلك ويقاتلون أولياءك اللهم شتت شملهم اللهم مزق جمعهم اللهم خالف بين كلمتهم وزلزل أقدامهم وأنزل بهم بأسك الذي لا تغده عن القوم المجرمين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر من نصر الإسلام والمسلمين واخذل من خذل الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصرنا ولا تنصر علينا اللهم امكرنا ولا تمكر علينا ربنا لا تجعلنا فتنة للقوم الظالمين ونجنا برحمتك من القوم الكافرين اللهم إنا نجعلك في نحورهم ونعوذ بك من شرورهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.